And it's all yours now. You have to press the talk button there. Sorry.
Right. My portion of the presentation deals with the perception and care of elder Hmong Americans with dementia. I want to begin by providing a little bit of background about the Hmong. They're an ethnic minority from China and Southeast Asia. The largest population of Hmong in the world continues to live in China, but during the Han Dynasty, the Hmong began migrating out of China into Laos, Vietnam, Thailand, and there's a small number in Burma. The majority that are living in the United States originated from Laos. They assisted the United States during the Vietnam War when that war spilled over into Laos. They aided the Americans by monitoring the Ho Chi Minh Trail, gathering intelligence information for the CIA, and they also rescued U.S. pilots who had been shot down. After the communist takeover in 1975, the majority of Hmong were left to find their way out of Laos into Thailand. That meant that they needed to go on foot through the jungles and cross the Mekong River, where they fled to the refugee camps in Thailand, and they began migrating to the United States in the mid-1970s. The Hmong are a rapidly growing population of minorities in the United States. The 2000 census reported that there were close to 200,000 Hmong living in the United States. But the Hmong leaders believe this to be a 50 to 60% underrepresentation. Even with that in mind, that's a 97% increase since the 1990 census. And again, the 2000 census reports that of those, there's a 55.6% were foreign born, and only a small number were 65 years or older. So only 2.8% of the population were elders. And of those elders, 64.1% were unable to speak English. So they speak Hmong, which is language that is unique to the Hmong population. Now, in looking at those statistics, we know it's a bit outdated because we are in the process of collecting the 2010 data. But currently, the Hmong National Development estimates that there is close to 300,000 Hmong Americans living in the United States. In looking at healthcare issues, particularly dementia, with the Hmong American population, it's important to have an understanding of the family plan role in the decision-making process. The Hmong are organized into an 18-clan structure. Generally speaking, clans are identified by the person's last name. So examples of last names which represent clan structures would be Xiong clan, Vang, and Cha. And the family is a subcomponent of the clan. Within the family, the members have well-defined roles and responsibilities. The Hmong are traditionally a patriarchal minority. They have strong family bonds that are based on interdependence rather than independence, as us as a dominant culture. So they believe that any life decision that is going to affect one family member will have either a direct or an indirect impact on all of the family members. And it's for that reason that decisions are made as a group, not on an individual basis, but as a group under the leadership of the eldest male. It is only when there is a conflict with that decision-making process that you would then go to a clan leader and consult the leader for a decision. But the clan leader is not routinely involved in those decision-making processes. Another important aspect is spirituality. Now, traditionally, the Hmong practice animism and ancestor worship, and these beliefs are strongly intertwined with the beliefs related to health and illness. When I refer to animism, I'm talking about, and I'm just going to, this is going to be somewhat of an oversimplification, but traditionally, and again, I'm not saying that all Hmong Americans believe this, but traditionally, they believe that persons have multiple souls. And illness is caused, or spiritual illness is caused, when there is disharmony of those souls. And I'm going to go into that in more depth later on. And when you have a spiritual illness, the only person that can treat that would be a shaman, which would be a traditional healer. They also traditionally believe that some illness has a biological cause. And for illness of a biological cause, that can be treated with herbs or other organic substances. And organic substances might include animal parts, such as, for example, a ground rhinoceros horn. Now, Hmong Americans have their spiritual beliefs have been influenced by the religious beliefs of the dominant cultures where they have resided, such as Laos, Thailand, and the U.S. So in addition to animism, they've also been exposed to Christianity and Buddhism. It is believed or estimated, and this is a rough estimate, but it is estimated that approximately 70% of the Hmong Americans who are residing here continue to practice forms of animism and ancestor worship. It's also important to identify that Hmong Americans who self-identify as Christians may retain traditional beliefs of animism to varying degrees. Those who have been born and raised in the animistic belief system may, during times of crisis, convert back to their animistic belief systems, for example. So spiritual status may change over time. It's important to recognize, and I can't emphasize this enough, that Hmong Americans are a heterogeneous group. They're heterogeneous in regards to their spiritual beliefs, their level of education, their ability to speak English, whether they have retained their traditional Hmong language, or whether they are bilingual, or whether they can only speak English and maybe they are not able, with some of the younger, able to speak Hmong language. The country of birth, majority of elder Hmongs are born in Laos. Once in a while, during a study that I will be presenting to you later, I encountered a Hmong American who was born in Vietnam, but overall they are born in Laos. And there is degree of acculturation with the Hmong American population. Once again, the elders are generally, but not always, retain more of the cultural beliefs and values. We do not actually have any statistics regarding the number of Hmong Americans who have dementia. It's been a relatively neglected issue until very recently. If you remember, there's only a small minority of elder Hmong Americans who were living in the United States during the 2000 census. But this is a very important and timely issue. And to emphasize this, there was a Hmong American man, and this occurred in 2005, who had memory impairment and confused, and he wandered away from his home, and he was not found until 21 days later. And his story made the front page of Hmong Today, which is a Hmong national newspaper. And when he was found, he was in a state of dehydration and malnutrition and required hospitalization for that. But he did recover. I've kind of talked a little bit about the historical context of the Hmong in general, but I would like to discuss now the historical context of how the Hmong view memory impairment and confusion in elders. This is not a new concept to the Hmong. They have an ancient Hmong proverb that compares an elder who has memory impairment with a tree that has been hollowed with age. So basically, they are saying that with age, the person becomes a shell of what they once were. So this is not a new concept. The concept of dementia, per se, or Alzheimer's disease are new terms to them. When I first became interested in the Hmong, and because of my interest in dementia, I wanted to learn more about how it was viewed. And I commissioned a shaman, Shaman Xiong, his son, who was an artist, Teng Xiong, and his wife, Mei Li. And Shaman Xiong had treated many elders in Laos for memory problems. And so he told the story in Hmong. His son created that in, or portrayed that through art. And his wife did the embroidery to create a story cloth, which is a traditional way of conveying their stories to non-Hmong. And this was actually, story cloths were originated during confinement in the refugee camps. It's a little bit difficult probably to see the detail on the web, but it is conveying a story of an elder woman who's in the garden. She's confused. Instead of hoeing the garden, she is sweeping the garden. And a shamanic healing ceremony is being performed in the lower left-hand corner. Following the ceremony, there's a feast, and following that, she is acting more appropriately with animals. This is just hitting the highlights of it, but if you'd like to learn more about this in detail, the article is published in the 2006 Journal of the Gerontological Nursing, and it goes into a lot more detail about healing ceremonies for persons, Hmong persons with memory problems, and some of the herbal remedies that are used. So I will refer you on to that if you'd like to learn more about that. So I wanted to learn more about the impact of living in the United States on some of these traditional values. So I conducted an ethnographic study to systematically explore this issue. I'm not going to go over the methodology in great detail, but this was a focused ethnographic study. I collected data over 2.5 years. It included participant observation, and that included going to shamanic healing ceremonies for elders with memory problems. It also involved going to a nursing home that had a unit specifically for Southeast Asian Americans. And it also involved in-depth interviews with Hmong American family caregivers, traditional healers such as shamans and herbalists, and community liaisons. And the purpose of this study was to explore the perception and cause of chronic confusion or dementia, and to learn more about the family caregiver experience, the access and use of Western healthcare services by Hmong Americans, and the use of traditional healers. This study was conducted in St. Paul and Minneapolis, Minnesota, the Twin Cities, which has the highest concentration of Hmong anywhere in the United States. California has the largest population of Hmong Americans, but the Twin Cities in Minneapolis has the largest concentration in that designated area. And then also this study extended into Eau Claire, Wisconsin, because strong networking between Eau Claire and the Twin Cities, and that provided me with some opportunities to participants there as well. The important thing in recruiting subjects to this study was, number one, I needed to get endorsement from Hmong American leaders, and the key to gaining access was probably even more importantly, or equally important, was the fact that I had a Hmong American nurse was one of the research team members. And we conducted the interviews together because she was, of course, bilingual. Here, the most important thing is that the majority of interviews were conducted in the Hmong language with the assistance of the Hmong American nurse, who was also a certified healthcare interpreter. I'm going to brush over that one. Here, of the family caregivers, not surprisingly, the majority were female. Of the community leaders, the majority were male, but actually the nurse made sure, she was determined to make sure that we had at least one female community leader included. And traditional healers was divided between male and female. As you can see, the majority of interviews were conducted in the Hmong language. The majority of caregivers retain the animistic ancestor worship belief system, and the community leaders were somewhat divided. The majority of caregivers, because they were older and had been born and raised in Laos, had no formal education. So these are things that are all going to influence their perception. I began the interviews by asking them what term they used, and although dementia and Alzheimer's disease was not a term that was familiar to the majority, they did have a term, and that is included on this screen. I am not going to attempt to pronounce that, because as hard as I try, I will probably get, because Hmong language is multi-tonal, I will probably give it the wrong tone, and I'll probably completely give you a different meaning. So I'm going to let Dr. Xiong handle that one. But one of the informants described it as, when people get old, there are so many things on their mind that they forget things, too many things to focus on, so their mind simply doesn't work. There were six caregivers six care recipients who had been seen by a physician for a medical diagnosis, but the caregivers did not, for the most part, understand what that diagnostic term meant. So there's the need for a lot of education. And as you can see from this next quote, that they thought dementia meant that the person was crazy. And this particular informant said, but I don't think she's crazy, it's just her memory. The perceived cause. Not surprisingly, the traditional healers attributed the elder's condition to soul loss. What I did find surprising was that I interviewed a Hmong Christian minister as a sort of an informal leader of the community, and he said the cause of, and he did know what the term dementia, he was familiar with the term dementia. He said that it was caused from being unfulfilled emotionally. He added that the spiritual side is empty, so that they have no hope for the future. And he emphasized that the emotional affects the physical. When I explored the spiritual cause further with the shamans, they sort of identified three different spiritual causes. The first is that the elder is lonely. And when they get lonely and their spirit or soul becomes dissatisfied, it simply wanders away. And so the souls are not in harmony, and that causes the person to have memory loss and confusion. A second cause can be if an evil spirit invades or attaches itself to the person's body, or more specifically, if that evil spirit blocks the elder's mind so that that person does not know how to think clearly. That's the second cause. The third cause is if the evil spirit actually abducts the person's soul. That evil spirit is believed to torture the soul, causing the person to become, and this is a quote, become crazy and forgetful. Now, the majority of family members attributed memory impairment to the aging process. So, if you recall, when we talked about the Hmong proverb, that's exactly what the proverb attributed memory impairment to, was as the person gets old, it's like a tree, it becomes hollowed out. They become a shell of who they were. The majority of community liaisons identified stress as the cause, and Hmong elders have certainly experienced more than their share of stress during their lifetime. The stress of the war in Laos, or the Vietnam War, which extended over into Laos, and also the stress of adapting to life in the United States. Okay, now I'm going to advance into the experience of family caregiving. And one of the family caregivers said, in order for me to understand, I needed to understand this family care structure, and he explained it to me in a way that was very clear and meaningful. He identified five concentric circles, and beginning with the inner circle, you have the nuclear family that is comprised of the husband and the wife. And it's important to know that when that woman marries, she actually joins her husband's clan. So that is where her primary importance is, with her husband and her children. Now, one thing that I've always found a little confusing is that even though she joins her husband's clan, she traditionally, and this is changing with life in America as I understand it, but traditionally she will keep her last name. For example, she will keep her maiden name, her maiden last name. She doesn't take on her husband's last name. Okay, so the second responsibility as we're going out from that inner circle is the husband's family, because remember, she's joined his clan. Third would be the wife's family, the wife's family. And again, that is because the wife's brothers would be those who would have primary responsibility for her family. She would play a secondary role. And outward from that is the entire clan. And again, outward from that is the Hmong community as a whole. Within that caregiving structure, as I've already alluded to, it's the eldest Hmong son who has the primary responsibility for his aging parents. And some things never change despite which culture you're a member of. The wife is the one who is responsible generally for providing the actual hands-on care. But conflicts with some of this tradition are beginning to emerge due to the changing roles and lifestyles of Hmong who are living in America. Okay, in general, something that's impressed me was that the caregiving role was viewed as reciprocal. It was a return of love and care for that which was given by the elder. It was also viewed as a model of traditional values for the younger generation. You want to make sure that you're teaching the younger generation how to properly care for the elder so that as you become an elder, you will be cared for in the way that you would desire. Overall, female caregivers were very pleased to devote their time and attention to the care of a family member and took tremendous pride in this. But it was much more difficult for those who were forced to juggle a career outside of the home. They had to take care of their career, their husband, their children. And I would like to give you a quote because I cannot express this better than this quote from one of the informants. Here it goes. I feel good about having that responsibility, being a caregiver. But sometimes it is frustrating because I'm not able to do what I think I should be doing. I'm a mom and I have children of my own. I'm a full-time employee. My mother worked all of her life, but she had flexible hours where she could do the kinds of things that she needed to do. There are times when I feel, why can't I do as good a job as she would be able to do? I keep thinking, why can't I do that? I should be able to do that. I should be able to deal with this, but I just can't. When your kids start reminding you of things that you should be doing that you're not, or that you're being mean, or that you don't spend enough time with your mom, you really start to wonder, what are they seeing and what am I teaching them? And it took a lot of courage for her to be able to express that to me. Okay, I mentioned earlier that animism played an influence in the perception and care of elders with memory problems. Ancestor worship also plays a part. And in ancestor worship, there's the belief that ancestral spirits continue to influence the lives of living family members. So, it is believed that the elder must be cared for in a respected manner with love and devotion during their final years. If not, they can cause harm to the caregiver and the family member once they transfer over to the other world. Preferred treatment, I'll just briefly go over this. As you recall, generally the caregivers believe that it was caused from aging process. But despite their personal beliefs, if the care recipient retained the traditional beliefs and believed that it was attributed to a spiritual cause, they brought in a shaman. The Christian minister felt that prayer was warranted as soon as signs began to appear of memory impairment. And I was even able to attend an adapted version of a healing that was performed by a minister. And during that it's important, I think, to understand too, the minister was Caucasian, but there was an animal sacrifice in that ceremony, and that sacrifice was made for God. And this was for an elder who had been born and raised in the animistic belief system and had converted to Christianity upon arriving to the United States. Support groups. There was not, Hmong family caregivers did not actually see a need for support groups. And one specifically stated that they didn't understand why you would seek assistance from a, quote, stranger to discuss such a sensitive issue. Another said that you needed to talk it over with someone in the family and emphasized that it was important to keep that information in the family. So I felt very honored that they were able to share as much information with me as they did, because they were very selective about who they did share information with. Nursing homes was a relatively new concept to Hmong Americans. And not surprisingly, overall, they did not believe in it. They believed that when thinking back on those concentric circles, that there would always be someone to care for the elder, even if it meant going out into the greater clan. If a person did need to be placed in a nursing home, there were some specific criteria that needed to be met. One was that they had Hmong speaking staff, that they served culturally appropriate food, that it would be located in close proximity to the family so that the family could come and visit them, that it was a welcoming environment for family members, and that some traditional ceremonies could be held. One such ceremony is hupli, which is a soul calling ceremony. It's not a full-blown healing ceremony. It's takes much less time and it's much quieter, but it does involve banging a gong. And those who are Christian believe that there should be prayer ceremonies. And when they were referring to that, they were not referring to anything with an animal sacrifice, because most of the Christians, Hmong Americans that I encountered, were strongly opposed to any sort of animal sacrifice. And in conclusion, as Hmong Americans are aging, there will be an increased risk for dementia. It's the care of these elders are posing new challenges for the community. A lot of these is just summary information, but the role of the family and the clan are primary factors in determining care, as well as their spiritual beliefs. Again, dementia has been a neglected issue in the Hmong American community. There's a critical need for adopting or developing culturally and linguistically appropriate information on this topic, and outreach efforts need to focus on with establishing trust and rapport with the authority figures within the Hmong community. I've briefly gone over this information with you. It is written in more depth, both in dementia and ethnicity, and also an article that was published in the Hallium International Journal of Aging, and I've written the complete citation there for you. Just one other thing. As an initial step in developing information that is culturally responsive, I teamed up with Sarah Langford, who at the time was a nursing student at Johns Hopkins University, and we wrote a children's book called Grandfather's Story Cloth. It's about a little boy, Shersheng, whose grandfather was born in Laos, lived through secret CIA war, and while he lived in a refugee camp, he had created a story cloth. And Xuxing uses that story cloth to learn to stimulate remote memory. Grandfather tells him about his life. Xuxing, in summary, learns of the sacrifices that grandfather has made and realizes that it's now his turn to help in the care of grandfather. And it is a bilingual book. And I just wanted to include one of the illustrations. And the reason I think that this illustration is important, I had used general themes from the ethnographic study to create the storyline. And in this picture, grandfather is bearing a silver bar in the garden. He thinks he's back in Laos and he's hiding his family's wealth from the enemy. But the important thing is, if you look on the back of his shirt, there is an applique. That applique indicates that a shamanic healing ceremony has been performed. Now, early in the book, it is very clear that grandfather has been seen by a physician, and he has received a diagnosis of probable Alzheimer's disease. But here, what we are also saying is that grandfather's spiritual needs are being met as well. And I'll be able to answer questions later. And at this, my portion of the presentation is over, but we are going to Dr. Xiong, who will be presenting on assessment and diagnosis and working with families of elders among Americans.
Great. And thank you, Dr. Gerdner. This is John DeMario at the Stanford Geriatric.
Good afternoon from Wisconsin. It's in the afternoon over here. It's probably in California, just shortly after the 12 o'clock hour. So, John, do you have my presentation on? Or?
Sorry about that. One moment.
Okay.
That would be important.
There we go.
There you are.
Thank you, John. Well, from my presentation, we'll pretty much cover the, from a clinical condition standpoint, in regard to dementia within the Hmong Americans elders. And so basically, I was starting saying by the Hmong words, simply meaning being free. And a case examples that I would like to present today would be a case that I have in my clinic. Mrs. Yang, or Mrs. White, is an 84-year-old Asian female woman who lives with her son and daughter-in-law, and her five grandchildren. She was brought into the clinic by her son because of her confusion, memory loss, moodiness, and communicated difficulties. And she has this ongoing for the past 2 years. The son simply saying that, quote, "My mother has been like this, and I ashamed to take my mother out to the public place because they might think that she is crazy and I might simply lose face. We have done everything we could at home and nothing has helped. We have tried more traditional treatments, modalities, including herbs, shamanism, and magic healing. A patient has not seen a physician for the past 2 years, and as her past medical history includes hypertension, she had too many stroke and osteoarthritis of the lumbar spine and a history of chronic gastritis. Her current medications includes traditional herbs and an aspirin 81 milligram daily. On her exam, her vital signs pretty much within the normal range. She was alert, orientated tons 1. She presented with no acute distress. Other exams pretty unremarkable, including the heart and the lungs. When I evaluate her for her psychiatric evaluation, she's actually disorientated to time, place, and having some trouble remember her own son's name, basically. Her Hmong mini mental exam, she scored a total of 5 out of 24, which is a normal, to consider as a normal individual, you have to score greater than 20 out of 24. So just keep that in mind in regard to this case. We will rediscuss the case and at the end of the presentation. Chronological Hmong history, Dr. Garner already touched base how the Hmong got involved with the United States during the secret war in Laos, which is, if you see on the bottom of the screen, from 1963 to 1975. But basically, the Hmong actually lived in China way back before 27 BC. I won't go into detail because of the time limitation, but if you have my slide, you can just follow through with that. And we will skip this line. Dr. Garner already highlighted some of this point, as well as this slide right here. And for since the Hmong people tends to believe that animism and ancestral worship are a strong bond within the family, and also they truly believe that there's multiple souls, and if any one of the souls that leave the body will cause some sort of illness. And simply for dementia, they think that a specific soul has been lost, and that's why the person's become disassociated or disorientated or having a memory loss. And usually when there's a cause of spiritual loss that leaning toward dementia, they usually ask a shaman to come in to perform a ceremony. And usually the first ceremony, what they call it, Wenling Shai, which just try to determine what's the causation of that particular illness. And once they make a diagnosis, then they proceed with the treatment. And the treatment usually consists of another ceremony, which is meant or name call. I did not put that in the slide here, but to further explain how the shaman performed the ceremony, there are two ceremonies that they have to perform. And then if that individual becomes better or improve with their health, then they usually make another big fest and usually invite the communities and families to promote healing to that individual as well. So it usually consists of 2-3 process. Now the Hmong has a multi-toner and has 2 dialect, and one of them is called the White Hmong, which is Hmong Dao. Now, as you can see on the picture over the left side, that's a type of clothes that you can differentiate from a gray Hmong, which is Hmong Zhuo, or Hmong Ling, which is the type of clothes that they were wearing, which is on the right side. So the difference here is that you see the skirt that they're wearing, Hmong Dao, which is white Hmong. You can see the skirt that is pretty much white, and Hmong Zhuo on the skirt, it's pretty colorful, so you can pretty much differentiate between the two. As Dr. Garner mentioned earlier, there's no such word that directly translates the meaning of dementia. We use the term ding dong or ding dong in two dialect to describe an elder with severe memory impairment and or chronic confusion. As we translate it into English, meaning as a tree ages, it has holes, a person who ages becomes forgetful, and an old tree is hollow, and an old tree has memory loss or impairment. Again, there's no statistic documented the prevalence of the dementia in Hmong American as of today. Dr. Garner and myself, we are in the process of doing or writing more about dementia, and this is something that we will be doing in the future, is to collect data on the prevalence of dementia within the Hmong community, and we'll try to publish that probably within the next few years. Usually community leaders identify chronic confusion as a neglected health concern within the Hmong elders. Negative stigma to elders and extend to the entire family, not just an individual. To maintain the elder's dignity and respect within the community, usually family members postpone or avoid seeking help from persons outside of the family. As we know, in the Western medicine, researchers, the majority of Hmong Americans do not see the value of seeking Western medicines for treatment of elders with memory problems and chronic confusion. Overall, elders Hmong Americans usually limited their use of medical care to in emergency situations. As a clinician or a physician, I usually, when I see a patient come into the clinic, they usually come in urgently and they request to be treated immediately. But when they have a chronic issue, they won't show up in the clinic. Let me just get an example of somebody who has diabetes. Usually they don't come into the clinic because that's considered a chronic condition. So they usually wait until the blood sugar is pretty high, up into the 400, 500, and then they will come in and then they expect you to bring the blood sugar down back to normal. That's just an example that I have been seeing in the clinic here. There's also a lack of available information regarding the prevalence of dementia within the Hmong community, because we have the tendency of saying, if I take my mother to see a physician or out to the public place, they might think that my mother is crazy. And as we pointed back into the case that I presented earlier, so they have a tendency to reserve that to reach out for help. There's also a compounded lack of available assessment tools that are linguistically and culturally appropriate for the assessment of cognitive impairment in Hmong elders. When I was working down in Madison, we came across the mini mental state exam by Fosting and McHugh, which developed in 1975. So what I did is that I took that mini mental state exam and remodified into a simpler or simple a sheet of the exam. And so we test among 25 individuals to use that form, and with people who does not have dementia. And then after that, we start to using that form, in which I will show later on the next slide. And we call it this adaptive version of the mental state exam, which developed in April of 2003 by myself and one of the psychiatrists, by Dr. Fred Coleman. And we continue to use that form since then for the past 7 years, in which pretty effective evaluating people who has dementia. I also used the Dahmer-Kolb exam to reevaluate the patient once they've been treated, and just to see where they at with the progression. Either their dementia progression is getting worse or getting better based on their daily activities and responding from the family as a caregiver. This is the form that the mental state that we modified back in 2004. We can make it blow a little bit bigger.
There you are.
It's, that helps. Thank you, John. We created a little bit more simpler, so the clinician or whoever using this form, it's much easier to fill it out and complete the exam within about 5 minutes. As you can see, the total points for this particular exam is 24 points. It's not 30 points as the mini mental state, the original one. We're using a little bit more simpler terms to evaluate the patients. For example, let me just get you an example on the Xavier 7. Let me just point out the arrow here. For the attention and calculation, instead of using can you subtract 7 from 100, what we typically do is give an example to the elders, say, if you have $10 and you spend $3, how much money you have left? So in a way, they should know how to use the money. The other thing we also use is that if you have 10 chickens and you sell 3 chickens, how many chickens you have left? So they should be able to do very easy, simple calculation. And if a person cannot do that, we're simply saying that there's something going on with their attention and calculation. Now the copy of the design, I use the same one. We're still using the same drawing. I don't have it in here, but the same one that the original drawing that used in Faustine's Mini Mental State. So if you want more detail on this here, I can simply send you some information on this form here. If you wanted to use this, you can download it from here too, and you can start using too. But if you have any question, you can certainly get in touch with me. And John, can we go back to the old slide? Now, as Dr. Garner talked about the Hmong perception toward dementia, basically we know that in Western medicine, there's many, there's multiple causes and risk factors associated with dementia. Vascular dementia is usually seen in about 20% of people, and with a series of transient ischemia attacks. And also the other part is hypertension, also one of the primary risk factors for vascular dementia. Disturbance in memory and cognition may be due to other factors such as depression. As you know that the elders usually present with dementia, depression initially, and as you start working, evaluating, then you start to pick up the dementia component of the individual. Hmong elders have a high rate of depression due to early loss, trauma, difficulties in adapting to life in Americans. I found that to be an issue within the Hmong elders, and most of them are either involved with a severe trauma, for example, head trauma, when they're still back in Laos, and now they're presenting with some symptom of confusion and moodiness. Dr. Garner pretty much highlighted on the spiritual healer part, so I'm going to skip this part here. One other thing we talk about, herbalists, even though a person given a diagnosis of dementia, they also not only being treated by medically, but also being treated at home by using herbal remedies. And you can see some of this in the backyard, where they grow in the backyard. There's fresh herbs that can be sell at a flea market, or dried roots, we call it chua hua, which can be sell on the street or in the flea market as well. Organic substance such as rhinoceros, bone, skin, dried blood can be also used in treating dementia as well. But there's no clinical proven evidence saying that this will work, but these are the things that they might want to try, trying to bring the individual to the to see a physician. Other traditional treatment modalities, including cupping, tsua, or vigorous massage, or several spoon, rubbing, pinching, and massage. One of the notes that I want to make on this slide is that you might encounter a patient has multiple bruises on their back, on their arms, on their forehead. Try not to make a mistake by saying that this is a negligent or physical abuse. You might want to get a little bit more information. What I'm saying is not to exclude that this is a cause by physical abuse, but on the other hand, you want to ask a little bit more history and to see where, why did they get the bruise. I have a couple patients that came up to me, and what I have been observed, for from other physician was that, well, I need to report this incident. The skin is bruised. And what do you think? And I said, well, let's just do a little more information, and found out that she actually was using massage and also silver spoon rubbing. And so in that particular case, we did not report to the elders abuse agency. Now, in treatment summary, look at the Western medicine. We have medication, anti-cholesterol receptor or transmitter, or cholesterol esterase inhibitors. In my practice, and also within the Hmong community, it appears that Aricept seems to be very useful. Somehow, I'm not sure why is most helpful. Probably had to do the receptor that is more sensitive to the Aricept. Anti-depression, I also found out that paroxetine or Paxil seems to be working well with depression patients. As far as antipsychotics, Zyproxia seems to be working really well. And anti-convulsant medication, majority of people are using gabapentin, Neurontin. There's a new medication out there, also serve the same purpose too. If you see on the screen, the blue one are the one that used mostly within the context of treating someone who has depression or associated with a dementia, as opposed to other use of medication. Traditional medicines, including spiritual healing, shaman, magic healer, praying, herbal remedies, as we discussed early, and other traditional modalities. Recommendation: establish rapport and trust from the patient and provider relationship. It's important to note that a professional Hmong medical interpreter or a cultural broker is most useful in terms of doing translation or interpretation. Try to avoid discussing important topics or care issues with the patient alone. You want to identify a family member or a clan leader of the patient, and organize a family conference that includes an invitation to the clan leader as well. You want to discuss important topics, including pathological process of the disease, prognosis, or treatment plan in a culturally and linguistically sensitive manner before, right, and avoid any dogmatic statement when discussing the prognosis, and obviously include the clan leader in the decision-making process. Be supportive of the family and clan leader wishes. These are just some of the tools that you can use in clinical practice, and you will have a better rapport and more trustful relationship between the providers and the patient. Now, going back to our patient, if you are an outsider and if you don't know, if you're going to learn something, these are the three words that everyone recommended. Hello, you can say Nya Zhong, thank you, Wo Zhao, see you later, Xin Ji Duo. So those are the three things that you can learn, and when you see a Hmong patient, you can actually say that, and they will look at you and they say, well, that provider or individual really know my cultures, and this is someone that I can trust. And so basically, that's the end of this presentation, and we'll go with the questions. I know we're running out of time here shortly, but...
Thank you, Dr. Xiong. Yes. And I want to, we do have a couple of questions that came in on the chat window here. And I don't know, I'm sorry, oh yeah. And so I think if we want to address maybe the first one, it's about, it's a question that came in asking, the term crazy has been used several times as a quote from the interviews with Hmong people. What seems to be the perception or meaning of the word crazy within the Hmong people or those you interviewed? I guess it's maybe more for, yeah, if you want to talk, you have to click that. Yeah, yeah, you do. The other one. There we go.
That's a very good question. I was probably making an assumption that they were defining it the same way that I was defining it. Dr. Xiong, do you have additional insight into that?
Yes, basically, we don't have a Hmong term that actually describe dementia or confusion. So instead of, if we translate the word crazy, meaning that nouveau, which means that it's a general term that we use and it's very non-specific. A lot of people tends to use the word crazy because that's one of the words that they learn as they come into the U.S. And so they tend to use that word more frequently as opposed to confusion or memory loss. So it's just a term I think that is more universally used and people just easily accept the term and start using that term.
Great, thank you. And let's see, we also had a question about the references. I did want to mention too that if you are interested in the articles from Dr. Gerdner, you can contact her. She'll be glad to help you out with getting with learning more about the articles that she referenced. And I think the same thing goes for the mini mental. If you had any questions about that, you could ask Dr. Xiong about that as well. I don't know if we had any other questions come through here. Let's see, I think it looks like that was the bulk of the questions. But yes, if you have any questions, go ahead and use the chat window on the lower left. If not, but other than that, I'd like to direct you towards the survey. We'd like to ask you if you could complete a questionnaire about our webinar today. And that, if you could just click on the link, I believe if there's a web link there, and if you just click on it, it should open a new window. Yes, it should open a new window. So if you click on that thing, the link that's under Web Links 5, it should open a new window with a survey. And you could complete, if you could complete that survey, that would be great. It would provide us with lots of feedback and information about what you thought about the presentation today. And also, if you have any ideas about future topics or presentation or suggestions for the webinars in the future. So we'll keep the line open, but if not, it looks like we're all set for today. And I'd like to thank Dr. Gerdner and Dr. Xiong for presenting today. It's been a fantastic presentation, and I'd like to thank you all for attending the presentation today. If you have any further questions, you can contact me on email, or you can contact the presenters. If you contact me on email, I'll be able to direct the questions to the appropriate source. Have a nice day. And Dr. Xiong, you can go ahead and disconnect your microphone too. I think we're all set. It looks like we did have a question in, another follow-up question, asking about whether there was any indication that the Hmong people associated psychiatric illness or mental illness in a way that was not associated with confusion. I see. I don't know if either Dr. Gerdner or Dr. Xiong want to address that, or if that was a question that you want to respond to.
Sorry, John. I have my headset off.
Sorry,
but
what
was the question?
Oh yeah.
Again?
So we'll go ahead. So the question was asking if there was any indication that the Hmong people associated psychiatric illness or mental illness in a way that was not associated with confusion. I guess I don't know if that's a way of putting it, but I guess maybe the question is asking about maybe ways to refer to psychiatric illness, perhaps, in the community. Does that sound right?
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Maybe another way of putting it, or I don't know if that's a question, perhaps, but I assume that's what the question is asking about, mm-hmm. is choice of words or semantics.
Sure, yeah. We usually involve with a psychiatrist as well as primary care physician. Mm-hmm. So if somebody who came in with severe dementia and they do have some hallucination, auditory, visual hallucinations like that, we also work with the psychiatrist as well and to reconfirm that those are the signs and symptoms or clinical presentation of severe dementia. And then we have them involved as well. Now, from my clinic, practicing as a physician, when I put the patient on the medication, I actually talked with the psychiatrist too, and then we kind of co-managed the patient together. I tend to see my patient a bit closer in time frame as opposed to a psychiatrist. So for example, a patient like this 84-year-old, I saw her on a monthly basis, but she only saw the psychiatrist every 3 to 6 months. So I don't know if I answered the question correctly, but that's how we, as a primary physician, we practice. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Yes, I think that, oh, I see. Okay, actually, there's a follow-up here. So maybe I'll read it again, and then I'll read the follow-up. So I guess the question was, any indication that the Hmong people associate psychiatric illness or mental illness in a way that was not associated with confusion? So, for example, how might the family describe depression or psychosis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's usually when they present in a clinic, it's more so of label has been crazy. Just like at the patient that we have, first of all, the whole family think that she's crazy and she's psychosis. That's the first thing. It's a connotation that a lot of people use to label people. So when they come in, they say, well, my grandma, I think she's crazy. My mother, I think she's crazy. On the other hand, they just labeling as being crazy or having psychosis. Not to exclude that completely too, but by evaluation and by getting the history in detail, and you start to separate and take it out, okay, this belongs to depression, and this part going to with the psychosis, and then not all people who has dementia will have depression, but they do have some sort of component with psychosis as well. We have another patient who's in her 70s, presented with wandering down the street, talking to herself, having hallucination, seeing people in the room. Someone like this, it's a little bit harder to work as opposed to confusion. If somebody who's very confused, then we say, well, could be dementia. On the other hand, if somebody starts to have hallucination in both auditory or visual hallucination, then we tend to think of a psychosis. And that's how you separate the two. We do have patients come in that have both dementia and also psychosis symptoms as well.
Great, great. Thank you very much. And I think that looks like it was the final question that's come through. So I think we'll conclude for today. But definitely, if you have any questions, you can feel free to use the chat window.